Today I'm going to talk about meta-epidemiology. The problem is that meta-epidemiology is a bit complex. So in fact, we need to talk before about meta-analysis to understand how to conduct meta-epidemiological studies. So this is why perhaps this lecture will take a little bit longer than 1 hour, if you don't mind about that. If you have any questions at any moment, you can send them by chat. For me, it would be easier to see the question and to answer them. So don't hesitate to ask questions, but please do it by chat. Okay, so we are going to follow this outline. First, I'm going to talk about meta-analysis and evaluation of heterogeneity, and then we are going to see what meta-epidemiological studies are, and you will see that in fact it's a kind of extrapolation of meta-regression that we use for meta-analysis. So I will talk about the concept, then the different methods to conduct meta-epidemiological studies, and then the limits. My talk won't be too statistical, but it's possible, if you are interested in such topic, to further discuss the statistical issue later with me. So, a meta-analysis is a statistical method to combine the results of several studies to obtain a summary measure. And it's very interesting, in fact, to do this type of statistical analysis, because it will allow the summary of the amount of data. So, in fact, we need meta-analysis because we have a huge amount of data in the literature. So there are so many published studies. In 2010, it was estimated that there were 75 trials published every day. And if we print the first page of all articles indexed in the Web of Science, in fact, we will have a mountain as high as the Kilimanjaro. So, in fact, when we are interested in a research question, very frequently, we have many studies having evaluated this research question, and sometimes the results of this study are discordant. So, we need to summarize the literature, and also we need to explore the inconsistencies in the results of the different studies. Meta-analyses are also interesting because they will allow for an increased power to show a statistically significant result. And also, we will have an improvement of the precision of the estimation of treatment effect. But a very important point is that meta-analysis should be preceded by a systematic review. So, just a short definition of a systematic review. A systematic review of all available evidence for a well-defined, precise question follows a rigorous and reproducible process. So, in fact, we are going to identify all relevant studies, published or not, and it's a critical review. We need to evaluate systematically the methodological quality of each identified studies. And then, if it's possible, because it's not always possible, we are going to see when it's possible, we are going to combine the results of the different studies with a meta-analysis. So, it's very important for meta-analysis to be preceded by a systematic review. But as you can see in this figure, it's not always the case. So when you read a report reporting the results of a meta-analysis, you need to check that. This is an important point. You need to evaluate the quality of the systematic review. We are not going to discuss today, because we won't have enough time, about how to do a systematic review, but this is a very important point for you also, whatever the type of your project. And so it's really important to know how to do a systematic review. And according to me, the systematic review should be the first step of the PhD. But when you have a systematic review, as you can see, it's not always possible to conduct a meta-analysis. So when can we do a meta-analysis? To be able to do a meta-analysis, of course, we need to have more than one study identified answering the research question. I say that for you, it seems very evident, but for Cochrane reviews, many Cochrane reviews have no included study in the meta-analysis to show that, in fact, we have the gap in the research evidence on the topic. But if we want to do a meta-analysis, we need to have at least two studies answering the research question. And a meta-analysis with one study is the result of the study. Another important point to be able to do a meta-analysis is that we need to have characteristics of identified studies, not too different. In fact, as we're going to see later, we are not going to mix various topics together. We need to have about the same population and the same interventions in the experimental and control group. Of course, we know that we will have differences between studies. This is normal because we won't have exactly the same studies, the same population, and exactly the same dose of treatment, for example. But we need to have characteristics of identified studies not too different. Also, a meta-analysis is for a given outcome. So, we may have different definitions for the outcome, but to do a meta-analysis, we need to have the studies having evaluated the same outcome. And a last point that is very important, and it's a key problem for us when doing meta-analysis, is that because most meta-analyses are conducted based on what it is reporting in study articles, we need to have the results for each study clearly reported. And in fact, for those who are going to conduct meta-analysis, you're going to see that it's a big problem because, for example, sometimes we have the mean pain level in one group, but not the standard deviation. And in fact, to be able to do a meta-analysis for a continuous outcome, we need to have the number of patients analyzed in each group, the mean level in each group, and the standard deviation. For a binary outcome, like the mortality at 30 days, for example, we need to have the number of events in each group and the number of randomized patients in each group. So, very frequently, this is not clearly reported in articles, particularly for continuous outcomes. And so, if it's not clearly reported, we will need to contact the authors, but as you know, they may not answer, and so we won't be able to include the study in the meta-analysis. So, it's not always possible to do a meta-analysis. So, now we are going to see very simply how to do a meta-analysis. This is very important to understand the concept. The first step is to calculate treatment effect in each study. So, after doing the systematic review, we have identified relevant studies in the topic. We have selected the studies, and now we want to combine the result. In fact, in the literature, in the different articles you're going to identify, the results won't be reported the same way. For example, for a binary outcome, sometimes you will have a comparison of two percentages, sometimes you will have a relative risk, sometimes you will have an odds ratio. So we need to have a treatment effect expressed exactly the same way for all studies. So the first step is to define a measure of treatment effect that we are going to use for all studies. So I'm going to focus on binary outcomes for this lecture, but it's also, of course, possible for continuous outcomes. For binary outcomes, as a measure of treatment effect, we can take the relative risk or the risk ratio. This is exactly the same. We are going to see how we calculate that. We can take the odds ratio and we can take the risk difference. And I just remind you that all estimations of treatment effect should be presented with 95% confidence intervals. So, I'm not going to detail all statistics, but it's important to understand and to do a short reminder on how to calculate odds ratio. So, the odds ratio is a very common measure for treatment estimation of treatment effect for binary outcomes. And so, in fact, it's a ratio between two odds, the odds in the experimental group that is defined as the number of events out the numbers without event. Okay? And now the denominator is the odds in the control group, so the same, the number of events out of the number without events. And so the odds ratio is the ratio between these two odds. For meta-analysis and for meta-epidemiological studies, we frequently, we use most of the time log. Okay, so we are going to transform the odds ratio. And we, of course, we need to calculate the variance using this formula. For the relative risk or the risk ratio, this is not the same way of calculating it. The relative risk is the number of events in the experimental group, okay, out of the total number of patients analyzed, okay? So this is the risk in the experimental group, and for the risk in the control group, the same, the number of events in the control group out of the total number of patients analyzed in the control group. And the relative risk or the risk ratio is the ratio between these two risks. And I give you the formula to calculate the variance as well. So it's very important when you decide which measure of treatment effect to use to be aware of that. It means to be aware of the pros and cons of using an odds ratio or a relative risk. Okay, so odds ratios are very frequently used, but they may overestimate the relative risk, especially for common events. So it means that when the events are frequent in the population with a proportion of about 20 or 30%, okay? We usually say that the odds ratio is a good estimation of the risk ratio for rare events. Okay, as you can see in the figure. So in fact, for meta-analysis, probably it's more adapted to use relative risk or risk ratio rather than odds ratio. For meta-epidemiological studies, we prefer to use odds ratio because odds ratios have more statistical properties compared to relative risk. Okay, and I'm going to explain that later in the part concerning meta-epidemiological studies. So my advice for a meta-analysis, you could prefer relative risk as a measure of treatment effect. For meta-epidemiological studies, we prefer to rely on odds ratio. So, the first step is to estimate treatment effect within each study. So here we have 7 studies, the number of events in the experimental group, the number of patients analyzed in the experimental group, the same for the control group, number of events in the control group, number of patients analyzed in the control group. Okay, so using the formula I gave you earlier, we calculate the log odds ratio and the variance for each study. Okay. So we have for each study, the measure of treatment effect explained exactly the same. Then the second step is to combine the different studies to do the meta-analysis. So the concept is that we need to have a weighted mean because more participants and more events are likely to show more robust results. Okay? So in fact, it's absolutely not appropriate to do a simple mean. We need to take into account and the result of the meta-analysis, the precision of the treatment effect in each study. So if I have a study with many patients and many events, this study is going to contribute a lot to the result of my meta-analysis. In contrast, if I have a small study with few events, this study is going not to contribute a lot to the result of my meta-analysis. And so, in fact, we give weights to each study, and the weight is the inverse of variance for the treatment effect. And so, the result of the meta-analysis is the weighted average, and so this is defined as the sum of estimate multiplied by weight out of the sum of the weight. And the variance of my meta-analysis is defined as 1 out of the sum of the weight. So we are going to see that in our example. So I calculated the weight for each study. The weight is defined as 1 out of the variance. So if you do 1 out of 0.011, it's 90. Okay? And I calculate the weight multiplied by the log odds ratio for each study. It means that multiplied by that, and this gives you this result. Okay? So I do that for all studies. I have the sum of the weight, and I have the sum of the weight multiplied by the log odds ratios. Okay, so the result of my meta-analysis, the log odds ratio of my meta-analysis is the sum of the weight multiplied by the log odds ratio out of the sum of the weight. So this out of this, and the result is minus 0.2. 0.4. The variance of the meta-analysis is 1 out of the sum of the weight. Okay, so you have the result here. And the odds ratio is the exponential of that result. So the result of my meta-analysis here is the combined odds ratio of 0.82. Is it clear for everybody? Yeah? Okay? Okay. So it's just a small comment that in fact for the sum of the weight and for the weight, we usually put them out as percentages of the sum of the weight. Okay, so this is the weight here as percentages. And what is important is the result. We usually represent the result of a meta-analysis with the forest plot. So this is an example. Here, the outcome is 1 year mortality. The measure of treatment effect is the relative risk. Each line represents a study. This is the number of events in the experimental group out of the number of patients analyzed. This is the same for the control group. I calculated the relative risk for each study, and this is the weight defined as the inverse of variance for each study. Okay, on the plot, each result, each relative risk is presented with a square. The size of the square is proportional to the weight of the study in the meta-analysis. Okay, and the horizontal line represents the 95% confidence intervals. So we can see in the study that this study has the most important weight. Okay, and it's not surprising because this study included the highest number of patients. But if you look at the study just below, it's about the same number of patients, but the weight is not the same. This is due, this is related, because in fact, precision does not only depend on the number of patients, but also on the number of events. And in these studies, we have more events than in the study. This is why the weight is more important. Okay? So the result of the meta-analysis is expressed here. So this is my weighted average, and we can see in this result that there was no statistical significance between the experimental and control group because 95% confidence intervals include one. Okay? It's clear for everybody? Okay, so in fact, when we are doing, okay, thank you. When we are doing a meta-analysis, it's very important, it's crucial to systematically assess heterogeneity. And so when you do the meta-analysis, you should systematically present the result of heterogeneity. So we have an indication here, but heterogeneity is in fact a more complex concept. We are going to see that now. So, what is heterogeneity? Heterogeneity is defined by differences between studies within meta-analysis. And in fact, the statistical heterogeneity we are going to estimate when we do a meta-analysis is the fact that the treatment effect is not exactly the same from one study to another. Okay? And so, in fact, we have a difference in treatment effect estimated from each study that is more important than the one expected by chance only. The contrast hypothesis is the hypothesis of homogeneity. Treatment effect is exactly the same for all studies. Okay? And so what is important to understand is that heterogeneity, this statistical heterogeneity we are going to assess when we do a meta-analysis, is related to clinical and methodological differences. So clinical differences can be related to differences in terms of participants. If you identify studies to answer a specific question, you won't have exactly the same eligibility criteria in all studies. So you won't have exactly the same age range for all patients. You won't have exactly the same definition of the medical condition. You may have more severe patients in some studies and less severe in other studies. And for example, if you do a study in China and if you do a study in Africa and if you do a study in the US, it's also a source of differences in terms of characteristics of participants. You may also have differences in terms of interventions. Of course, when we do a meta-analysis, we focus on one intervention. For example, use of corticosteroids. But the dose, the duration, and the mode of administration of treatment, for example, an oral treatment compared to injections, could differ between the different studies. Also, we may have some differences in terms of control treatment. For example, in some studies, it could be a placebo. In other studies, no treatment. And in other studies, usual care. Okay? Just a comment now. It's not appropriate when you do a meta-analysis evaluating the treatment in which you are interested and either a placebo or an active treatment. It's not appropriate because it's not the same question. You cannot expect the same treatment effect when you have a comparison against placebo. It means no active treatment and an active treatment. So we should not combine these studies together in the same meta-analysis. Also, as I told you, a meta-analysis is for a given outcome, so the outcome should be exactly the same in all studies, but perhaps the definition may vary a little bit from one study to another. The follow-up duration may vary from one study to another, and also the measurement method. We may also have methodological differences. So it is related to variability in design and conduct in terms of randomization method. For example, some studies will use an adequate randomization method with a computer sequence. And in other studies, we are going to have inadequate randomization method, like for example, alternate randomization. It's the same for allocation concealment. It means that, in fact, when the physician is recruiting the participant, is not able to forecast in which group the patient will be. It's a very important concept in randomized controlled trials, and it's related to selection bias. Blinding, whether participants and physicians are blinded to the treatment received by the patient, and handling of missing data. Okay? So why heterogeneity is an important point and it could be a problem? As I told you, in fact, to be able to do a meta-analysis, we need to have studies on the same topic, evaluating the same questions, and it's not appropriate to combine apples and pears. Okay, in a fruit salad, it would be good, but not in a meta-analysis. So in fact, this is a classical example to say that. Okay, so it's very important to be able to combine only studies that are sufficiently similar to be comparable. Because when I showed you this, I did not do that manually. I could do, but it's not me who did that, and it's from an article. But in fact, it's very easy to obtain that. Most statistical softwares are able to obtain that. So in fact, you just have to put the data in the statistical software and you will have a beautiful forest plot. Okay? But the problem is that it's not always appropriate if you have two different studies in terms of characteristics. So you always have to ask yourself, is it appropriate to combine the results or not? Is it appropriate to do the meta-analysis? So, how it's possible to identify heterogeneity? In the forest plot, we saw some statistics at the bottom of the forest plot. But in fact, before looking at the statistics, we need to have a look at the characteristics of the included studies. Okay, so we do the systematic review, then we are going to report all study characteristics in terms of general characteristics, year of publication, in terms of population, characteristics of the chronic condition, severity of the disease, age range, in terms of interventions in the experimental and control group, and in terms of definition of the outcome. When we do this table, if the characteristics are too different, we should stop there and decide not to do a meta-analysis, okay? If we see that the characteristics are not too different, we could do the meta-analysis. And so, when we do the meta-analysis, before looking at the statistics at the bottom of the forest plot, we need to look at the forest plot visually and just to look at whether we have a feeling of heterogeneity or not. So to do that, in fact, we look at overlaps in 95% confidence intervals. If the 95% confidence intervals overlap between the different studies, it indicates that there is no major heterogeneity, okay? If you have outliers, it can indicate heterogeneity. So, a small exercise, what do you think about this forest plot? Heterogeneity or no heterogeneity? What is your feeling when looking at the forest plot? Do you have overlaps in terms of 95% confidence intervals or not? Do we have overlaps? Yeah, okay, thank you, Camilla. Exactly. In fact, we have 95% confidence intervals overlapping, so probably no major heterogeneity. Okay, thank you. Another example, what do you think about this one? Heterogeneity or not heterogeneity? No overlap. Thank you, Cecilia and David. Okay, so in fact, we have the feeling for this forest plot that we have more heterogeneity, okay? And this is the combined, the line for the combined treatment effect, and we have outliers. We have 95% confidence interval, not in overlap, okay? Okay, so after the visual inspection of the forest plot, we have the statistics for heterogeneity. And so a first statistic is the Cochrane's Q test to distinguish random error from heterogeneity. Okay, so the concept of this test is to test the homogeneity hypothesis. Do you remember the homogeneity hypothesis is that you have exactly the same treatment effect for all studies in the meta-analysis? Okay, and so in fact, this test estimates the gap between each treatment effect for each study and the combined treatment effect. Okay, and it follows a chi-square distribution with k minus 1 degrees of freedom, and k is the number of studies. So if we have a look to the example I gave you, in fact the result of the test is here. We have a very statistically significant p-value. Okay, so we can reject the hypothesis of homogeneity. Okay, so it's confirmation of our visual feeling. We have heterogeneity that is not related to random error, to chance, but that is due to heterogeneity. Is it clear? Okay, so in fact, the problem of this test is that finally we have low power when we have few studies. Okay, so if you have few studies, the test may not be statistically significant even if we have heterogeneity. Okay, in contrast, we may have excessive power to detect heterogeneity when many studies. So if I have many studies, I will have a statistically significant test even if not really heterogeneity. Another way to identify heterogeneity is the I-square. In fact, the I-square is from the Cochrane statistic and it's simple to interpret. It's in fact the proportion of variability that can be explained by heterogeneity rather than chance. Okay, it was a measure developed by people from the Cochrane collaboration, and so if you have an I-square between 0 and 40%, it indicates that the heterogeneity may not be very important in the meta-analysis. If you have I-square between 30 and 60%, it may indicate moderate heterogeneity, between 50 and 90, substantial heterogeneity, and between 75 and 100%, considerable heterogeneity. Okay, so this is the range given by the Cochrane collaboration. Usually from my own experience, when you have more than 50%, it indicates a substantial heterogeneity, and when you have more than 80%, probably you may have the questions of combining the studies together. Probably it was not appropriate to do a meta-analysis. It indicates too much heterogeneity. Okay, so again my example here. The I-square is at 85%, so considerable heterogeneity in the meta-analysis. And you can see that, of course, the visual inspection, the result of the Q-square test and the I-square gave concordant information about heterogeneity. So another example, what do you think about this one? Heterogeneity or no heterogeneity? No heterogeneity, exactly. In fact, if we look at the forest plot, we have 95% confidence intervals in overlap. The statistical test is not significant and the I-square is at 0%. Okay? Another example, what do you think about this one? Heterogeneity or no heterogeneity? No heterogeneity. Some heterogeneity. Alors, some heterogeneity for Lorenzo, heterogeneity for Van and Maria, and no heterogeneity for Alice. For me, there is heterogeneity in this forest plot. If you look at the forest plot, in fact, you have 95% confidence intervals that are not in overlap, for example, here and here. Okay. Also, we have a statistically significant test because the p-value is less than 5%. And so we can reject the hypothesis of homogeneity. And the I-square is at 72%, so it's important. Okay? It's clear for everybody? Okay, so in fact, we have evaluated how it's possible to identify heterogeneity. So now we are going to see strategies to deal with heterogeneity. In fact, there are two main models when we do meta-analysis, the fixed effect model and the random effects meta-analysis model. Okay, I'm going to detail this model a little bit later, but just the random effects meta-analysis model take into account between steady heterogeneity. Okay, so it's a way to deal with heterogeneity. Of course, I remind you that when you have too much heterogeneity, it's not appropriate to do the meta-analysis. Okay, and also we have possibilities to explore heterogeneity with subgroup analysis and meta-regression. And after, you're going to see with meta-epidemiological studies that, in fact, meta-epidemiological studies are an extrapolation of the meta-regression concept. Okay, so as I told you, we have two main models when doing a meta-analysis, the fixed effect model and the random effects model. The model I presented earlier in this lecture was the fixed effect model with the weighted average. Okay? So, in fact, the hypothesis we do with this model is that we have a common treatment effect, that is the true treatment effect, and the differences we have between studies are only related to random error, to chance, if you prefer. Okay? And so, it means that in this model, if you have differences, it's only due to chance. It means that if all studies were of infinite size and infinite precision, if we would have a very precise treatment effect, we will have exactly the same treatment effect in all studies. Okay? It's clear? So it's a very strong assumption. It means that, in fact, the differences we observe between studies are only related to chance, okay, and not to heterogeneity. The random effects model include some heterogeneity. In fact, we are not going to evaluate a common treatment effect, but we do the assumption that in each study, I will have a particular treatment effect, okay? And my meta-analysis will evaluate the mean treatment effect across my studies. Is it clear? And the main difference between the two models are related to weight, because in fact, in the fixed effect model, the weight is the inverse of the variance. In the random effects model, it's in the fixed effect model is the inverse of the variance of the treatment effect in the study. In the random effects meta-analysis model, it's the inverse of the variance of the treatment effect in the study plus the variance of the treatment effect between studies. And this is an important difference. Okay? So we are going to incorporate the differences between studies. Okay? So what is important for you to remind is that the fixed effect model estimates a common true treatment effect supposed to be the same for all studies. The random effects model estimates a mean and average treatment effect across studies. Okay? The weights for the trials differ between the two models. And because I have an additional component in the random effects meta-analysis model, the weights are more balanced with this model. Large studies will have a lower weight than in the fixed effect model, and small studies will have a larger weight than in the fixed effect model. Okay? So when I say that, you should tell me, but finally, because we always have differences between the studies in terms of populations, interventions, definition of the outcome, we should use a random effects model. No? What do you think? Because in fact, this model takes into account heterogeneity between the studies. You could be right. The problem is that the random effects meta-analysis model may surestimate treatment effect in case of small study effect. In fact, if you have a publication bias, you have a tendency for small studies to show a larger treatment effect. And it's a major problem, and it's mostly related to publication bias. And so with the random effects meta-analysis model, we are going to give a larger weight to small studies, okay? And you may overestimate the treatment effect. I'm going to show you an example. And the last point is that standard error for the combined treatment effect are larger, generally larger, with the random effects model than with the fixed effect model. So, usually what we should do is to do both fixed effect and random effects meta-analysis model and to compare the results. Many people previously did the fixed effect model, and in case of heterogeneity, statistically significant heterogeneity, they move to the random effects meta-analysis model. This is not appropriate to do that because of the limits of the heterogeneity test I showed you. Okay, so this is why probably it's more appropriate to do both models and to compare the results. So, an example. This is an example of a meta-analysis with the fixed effect model. Okay, my combined treatment effect is 0.69. And my 95% confidence intervals indicate that the difference between the experimental and control group is statistically significant. Okay? Same meta-analysis, but with a random effects meta-analysis model. I have about almost the same estimation of risk ratio. Okay, but the 95% confidence interval is larger and it doesn't include one. So the difference is no more statistically significant. Okay, and this is exactly what I was saying there. The standard error of the combined treatment effect and 95% confidence interval are larger with the random effects model. Another example, each meta-analysis ends with a presentation of the fixed effect and random effects model. And we have a huge difference between the two models here. Okay? And this is a very interesting example. In the fixed effect model, oh, I have a question from Eve. The second includes the number one. Yeah, right. Yeah, exactly. This is why it's not statistically significant. Okay. I have with the random effects meta-analysis model a larger standard error. And so if my standard error is larger, I have a larger 95% confidence interval. And so it includes one. And so it's no more statistically significant. It's not really evident in the figure, I agree with that. Is it clear? And the first note, exactly. This one doesn't include one in the 95% confidence interval. This one includes one in the 95% confidence intervals, okay? So I have a difference in the results, not in terms of combined treatment effect, but in terms of statistically significance. Okay? So here, in this example, I have a big difference between the fixed effect and the random effects meta-analysis model. With the fixed effect, my combined treatment effect is 1.01, and so the as you can see, with 95% confidence interval, it's centered on one. There is no statistical difference. Okay, but with the random effects meta-analysis model, my combined treatment effect is 0.76, and the 95% confidence intervals does not include one, so I have a statistical significant difference. So, in fact, in this example, probably this is what I was saying about the small study effect. So in this example, probably we have a small study effect that could be due to publication bias, for example. And in fact, the small study effect is one of the main limits of meta-analysis. It's the fact that small studies are going to show larger treatment effect than the larger studies in the meta-analysis. Okay, and in fact, we can see that here, the largest studies do not show, sorry, any large result. Okay, this one are centered on one. This one is probably significant, but it's close to one. And this one is smaller, significant, but relatively close to one. And if I look at the small studies, for example, this one, I have a larger treatment effect compared to these larger studies, and this probably explains the difference between the fixed effect and the random effect meta-analysis model. So if we have a small study effect, if we have publication bias, using only random effects meta-analysis model can give misleading results, because if I had only used the random effects model, I would have concluded to the benefit of magnesium in this indication, okay? And in fact, this conclusion probably is related to publication bias. So this is why it's important to present both and to interpret this result. Okay? Is it clear? Okay, so now we are going to see the transition with meta-epidemiological studies. And in fact, we have evaluated heterogeneity, okay. we have taken heterogeneity into account, and it's also possible to explore heterogeneity. And in fact, this is a very important and interesting part of meta-analysis, because this part can help to better understand why you have some differences in the results of the studies available in the literature. Okay, it allows you to understand why you have discordant results. So in fact, study characteristics may be associated with treatment effect, for example, methodological characteristics with randomization method, setting multi-center versus single-center studies, and treatment dose. Okay, so interesting to explore heterogeneity between studies related to these characteristics. And so to do that, we can do either a subgroup analysis or a meta-regression. So in fact, the principle of both subgroup and meta-regression analysis is that it concerns study level characteristics, not patient level characteristics. It's not appropriate to evaluate, for example, age of patients, but it's interesting to evaluate the study level, for example, whether the study is a single center or a multi-center study, whether the randomization method is adequate or not. And the principle of these two analysis, subgroup and meta-regression, is to estimate the interaction between the characteristic and treatment effect estimate. So in fact, we are interested in the following question: how treatment effect is modified by the characteristic? And to do that, we test interaction. So this is an example of subgroup analysis. This is a meta-analysis to evaluate the effect of management of parodontal disease during pregnancy on preterm birth. Okay, and in fact, they did this meta-analysis because the results were discordant in the literature. And in some studies, there was a benefit, and in other studies, there was no benefit at all. Okay, and so they did a subgroup analysis according to the quality of the trials. So this is the subgroup of low quality trials, and this is the subgroup of high quality trials. And after, they did an interaction test between these two subgroups. Okay? And so this is very interesting because, in fact, the principle is to estimate the combined treatment effect in each subgroup and to evaluate heterogeneity in each subgroup. If we look at the overall treatment effect, there is no statistical difference between the two strategies. Okay? But we have an important heterogeneity. If we look now within each subgroup, in the subgroup of low quality trials, we have an important treatment effect. Okay, with a relative difference of 48%, and it's statistically significant, and we have no heterogeneity in this subgroup. In the subgroup of high quality trials, we have no difference, no statistical difference, and also no heterogeneity. So what is very interesting in this example is that this subgroup analysis helped to understand that, in fact, the discrepancies we had between the different studies in the literature were related to the differences in terms of quality. Okay? So this is a very interesting example. Now, the meta-regression is in fact a kind of subgroup analysis, but for qualitative and quantitative variables. And the meta-regression is like a linear regression model. and we are going to predict treatment effect according to the study characteristic. The unit of analysis is the study, and the studies are weighted, okay? And it's recommended to use always random effects meta-regression to do this analysis. So this is an example of a meta-regression. It was a meta-analysis on the effect of corticosteroids in septic shock, okay, in patients in critical care units. And so, in fact, this is the treatment effect. This is the characteristic of the study in which I'm interested. And the characteristic of the study was the cumulative dose of the treatment. Okay. Each cycle represents a study. The size of the cycle is proportional to the weight of the study in the meta-regression model. Okay. And you have a regression line that is the result of the meta-regression. Okay, and we can see in this example that there is a significant interaction between the cumulative dose of treatment and treatment effect. Okay, so this is a graphical representation of the meta-regression model for the assessment of this characteristic. Is it clear? Yeah? Okay. So, thank you, Alice. Now, we are going to see the core of the lecture, but it's just an introduction, and really, I'm sure you will better understand meta-epidemiology after seeing all meta-analysis and evaluation of heterogeneity and meta-regression concepts. So, what is meta-epidemiology? Because you were there, there for that this morning, so I'm sure you are very impatient to know what is meta-epidemiology. In fact, meta-epidemiology is the evaluation of characteristics associated with treatment effect estimates using collections of meta-analysis. Okay, so you can see with my definition of meta-epidemiology that in fact we are close to the definition of the meta-regression. And the main difference is that we are going to generalize in a large collection of meta-analysis. Okay, so the first meta-epidemiological study was published in JAMA in 1995, and in this study, they evaluated the association between methodological characteristics such as the method to generate random sequence, allocation concealment, lack of blinding, exclusion of patients from analysis, and treatment effect estimate. And so in this study, they showed that if you have an inadequate method to generate random sequence, if you have a lack of allocation concealment or lack of blinding, and if you exclude patients from analysis, you're going to overestimate treatment effect compared to studies with adequate methods. Okay? Then after this study, other meta-epidemiological studies confirm these results, and what is important is that all these meta-epidemiological studies served as support for developing the Cochrane Risk of Bias tool. Okay? So, in fact, the first step of doing a meta-epidemiological study is to obtain a collection of meta-analysis. We are not going to focus at the beginning to the statistical method. What is important is your sample of meta-analysis. In fact, and it's not frequently detailed on reports of meta-epidemiological studies, but it could be a problem. To obtain a collection of meta-analysis, we should do a systematic search because we need to have a representative sample of meta-analysis. Okay, so it's crucial to define eligibility criteria and to follow this eligibility criteria. Okay, and of course, it's absolutely not appropriate. You have your collection of meta-analysis, you're doing your meta-epidemiological analysis, and you realize that there is one study showing no difference, and you're going to exclude this study. This is absolutely not appropriate. Okay, it's representative of the meta-analysis. We don't have to exclude a posteriori any study, okay? And we need to transparently reporting this selection process using a flowchart like in trials, like in systematic reviews. So this is an example of a meta-epidemiological study I published, and you can see that the flowchart is very detailed. In fact, I have a first step with the selection of meta-analysis, and after I also have eligibility criteria for individual studies within the meta-analysis, because in fact, for this study, I was interested in the difference in treatment effect estimate between single center and multi-center trials. So if I had no information on single center or multi-center status of the study, I had to exclude the study. Then we need to extract the data. Of course, we need to extract the characteristics of interest. So in my example, the difference between single center and multi-center study, I was interested to collect this information, but also we need to extract potential confounding factors, for example, risk of bias. So there are two main options to extract the data. You can extract the data directly from the systematic review, okay? But the problem is that some characteristics may not be systematically reported. For example, in Cochrane reviews, it's not always reported if you have a single center study or a multi-center study, okay? So, for my example, I had to go back to the individual trials, and it was for my PhD. It was my first work of PhD, and I can tell you that it was an important amount of work, okay? So you have to define that, and of course, as for all types of studies, you have to do a protocol with all eligibility criteria for the selection process and how you're going to extract the data. So now we're going to see the different options for statistical analysis. In fact, the strategy the most commonly used for meta-epidemiological analysis is the two-step approach described by Jonathan Stern. In this approach, and I'm going to take the example I gave you about the estimation of the difference in treatment effect between single center and multi-center trials, we need to do like for meta-analysis to define the measure of treatment effect, okay? And as I told you, for meta-epidemiological analysis, we prefer to use odds ratio than relative risk because odds ratio has more mathematical properties compared to relative risk. And so, in fact, I'm interested in the difference in treatment effect between single-center and multi-center trials. And we express the difference in treatment effect as a ratio of odds ratio. And this is defined as the odds ratio in single-center trials to the odds ratio in multi-center trials. We have to be sure of the coding. In fact, I have to have exactly the same direction for treatment effect in all studies and in all meta-analyses. And so, for example, if I consider that I have adverse outcomes, if I have an odds ratio less than one, it indicates a beneficial treatment effect. Okay? If I have, for example, like outcome mortality, if the odds ratio is less than one, it indicates a beneficial treatment effect. Okay? So in this situation, with the estimation of my odds ratio, if I have a ratio of odds ratio less than one, it will indicate larger treatment effect in single center than in multi-center trials. Okay? So this is just a convention, and we have to be sure that treatment effect is expressed the same way in all studies and in all meta-analyses. So after that, I have two steps. The first step is to estimate the ratio of odds ratio, that is my difference between single center and multi-center studies, for each meta-analysis. And in fact, to do that, I'm using a meta-regression model. So my meta-regression model is treatment effect predicted by single center status of the study. And the ratio of odds ratio is the exponential of the regression coefficient for my single center variable. Okay, so my first step is within each meta-analysis. I'm doing a meta-regression model to estimate my difference in treatment effect between single center and multi-center studies. Then my second step will be, because I will have for each meta-analysis a ratio of odds ratio, and so my second step is to combine these ratios of odds ratios using a random effects meta-analysis model. And it's important to use a random effects meta-analysis model because it takes into account that, in fact, my meta-analysis in my collections, they will evaluate different medical conditions, different types of intervention, okay? And also, the influence of the characteristics on treatment effect can vary from one meta-analysis to another. This is why it's important to combine using a random effects meta-analysis model. So with this model, I will have an average ratio of odds ratios across all meta-analyses. Is it clear for everybody? Yeah? Okay. So, as I told you, you have to be sure that all outcomes are coded the same way. For example, adverse. So, an odds ratio less than one indicates a beneficial effect of the experimental intervention. I'm going to give you an example. If you combine together pregnancy, the positive outcome, and lack of pregnancy, the adverse outcome, if you put that together, you're going to show contradictory results, okay? And so the difference will be compensated. This is why we need to have, for example, for a situation where you have in some studies pregnancy and in other situation lack of pregnancy, you need to transform the outcome to be all adverse. And another important point is that the bias should be in the same direction for all studies and meta-analysis. So my advice is to exclude comparison of two active treatments and also evaluation of safety outcomes. Because according to me, in these situations, I'm not sure what would be the direction of the bias. Okay, so I prefer to focus on efficacy outcome, so I'm sure to have to I'm sure that this is what I would like to show, another ratio less than one indicates beneficial effect of the experimental intervention. And also, I prefer to exclude comparison of two active treatments because, in fact, I'm not sure what will be the best treatment between these two active treatments. Okay? So this is just important advice. So, also, we are going to present the results of the meta-epidemiological study with the forest plot. So this is my example of a comparison of treatment effect between single-center and multi-center trials. Each line represents a meta-analysis. This is the number of single-center studies in the meta-analysis, the number of multi-center studies in the meta-analysis, okay? And here, it's the ratio of odds ratio. And again, the size of the square is proportional to the weight of my meta-analysis in my combined effect, okay? So, in fact, there was a subgroup analysis, but I'm not really interested in that for the moment. And so, in fact, I have, this is the first step, I have the difference in treatment effect expressed by a ratio of odds ratios in each meta-analysis, okay? And I did that using a meta-regression model. Then, second step, I combine all these ratios of odds ratios using a random effects meta-analysis model. And I obtain this result. The combined difference is 0.73, and it's statistically significant because the 95% confidence interval does not include one. And it means that on average, single-center trials are going to show a 27% larger treatment effect than multi-center trials. Okay? Is it clear? And of course, because I'm doing a meta-analysis, I need to evaluate heterogeneity. Okay? And this is just here, of course, I'm going to look at the forest plot, and I have the same methods for evaluating heterogeneity, the homogeneity test, the I-square, and also the between meta-analysis variance, tau square. Do you remember in the random effects meta-analysis model, I told you that, in fact, the weight, the variance was the variance of the treatment effect within the meta-analysis and the variance in treatment effect between, the variance of the treatment effect in the study, for the treatment effect in the study, and the variance of the treatment effect between studies. And this is the tau square I can evaluate to estimate heterogeneity. This is the same tau square here. Okay? Is it clear for everybody? Okay. So I told you that. And so here we can see that heterogeneity was not very important. The I-square was 12% and the statistical test was not statistically significant. So, this model, this two-step model, can be implemented in R and Stata, okay? What is important to remind is that to do this model, to do the meta-regression, in fact, you need to have at least three studies per meta-analysis, okay? And within these three studies per meta-analysis, you need to have at least one study with and at least one study without the characteristic. Okay, the problem is that this model is not really adapted to adjusted analysis. It's possible, in fact, to adjust only on one covariate, but in this case, to do the meta-regression, you need to have at least 4 studies in the meta-analysis. Okay, this is what I did. This was my main analysis, this result. Okay, and after I adjusted on each time on a different characteristic. So I adjusted on sample size and I adjusted on each domain of the risk of bias, and I also adjusted on funding. Okay, and so this is my combined result, and you can see that I have less contributing meta-analysis because I had to exclude the meta-analysis with only 3 studies. There is another method, another model that is recommended. It's a multi-level model. It was described by Sirsma, and in fact, it's a multi-level logistic regression model with random effects. A random effect for treatment effect across studies, and a random effect for the variation of the characteristic on treatment effect across meta-analysis. Okay, and this model is interesting because you can do multivariate analysis, and you can also evaluate the effect of characteristic with several modalities using this model. So I'll give you another example. This was a meta-epidemiological study to evaluate the association between trial sample size and treatment effect estimate. And in fact, for this study, we were interested in having sample size as a qualitative variable cut according to several thresholds. For example, less than 50, between 50 and 100, between 100 and 200, between 200 and 500, between 500 and 1000. Okay, and we wanted to show a kind of dose effect relationship between sample size and treatment effect. And we could do that with this model because, in fact, with this model, we were able to evaluate the effect of having a very small sample size, including less than 50 patients, compared to the larger studies, those including more than 1,000, and all the different subcategories. Okay, and you can see the dose effect relationship. And so this analysis is not possible with the two-step method. It's only possible with the multi-level model. And another model that could be used for meta-epidemiological analysis is a Bayesian model proposed by Welton. And it's also a multi-level model with random effects, but the interest is that you will be able to evaluate the contribution of the characteristic in the between trial heterogeneity. So you will have the association between the characteristic and treatment effect, the difference of the effect of the characteristic on treatment effect across the meta-analysis, and also the effect of the characteristics on within meta-analysis heterogeneity. So this is another option, and this could be interesting. But this model is more difficult to implement. So now we saw the different methods to do meta-epidemiological study, and it's very important to know the limits of meta-epidemiological study, because in fact the most important limit is that they are observational studies, so we have a risk of meta-confounding. And it's, for example, when I had a difference between single center and multi-center studies, it could be because there is a true difference between single center and multi-center studies, but it could be because single center have a lower sample size as compared to multicenter, and because of the small study effect, we know that the sample size has an important impact on treatment effect. It could also be related to risk of bias, because perhaps single center studies are going to have a higher risk of bias than multicenter studies. So, in fact, there is a meta-confounding, and as I told you, for this two-step model, the multivariate analysis is difficult, and we can take into account only one covariate at each time. So, if we have a difference, in fact, perhaps it's a true difference, but perhaps it's also related to this confounding factor, or to chance, or to publication bias. And another important question is that if you have a true difference, if, for example, it's a difference that is not related to chance, that is not related to meta-confounding, and not to publication bias, is it really a bias? For example, trials funded by industry are on average more likely to show positive results. But does it mean that we have to consider all trials funded by industry as at high risk of bias? It's a bit strong like assumption. So this is a really a difficult question, but it's an important type of study to explore, in fact, but not to give definite answers to this question. And I would like to finish with a particular case, because I told you that most meta-epidemiological studies were based on a collection of meta-analysis, but it's also possible to do meta-epidemiological studies on collection of trials. And so this is adapted to compare different types of outcomes or different types of statistical analysis for the same trials. And you need, as a first step, to identify trial evaluating both types of outcomes, okay? And this is very interesting because you have no meta-confounding and you're going to compare the two outcomes for the same trial. Okay, so this is the first step, and then the second step, you will have a difference in treatment effect for the two outcomes. You're going to combine this difference across the sample of trials using a random effects meta-analysis model, and you will have an average difference across the sample of trials. So we use this method to compare treatment effect between overall survival and progression-free survival in the field of cancer. And in this example, in fact, each line represents a trial, and the ratio, it was a ratio of hazard ratio, represents the difference in treatment effect between overall survival and progression-free survival. So this is also possible, but you need to have it's really particular because it's in fact adapted to evaluate, to compare different types of outcomes or different types of statistical analysis. And even if you don't have the problem of meta-confounding, you may have some limits because the statistical analysis is restricted to studies presenting both types of outcomes or of results. And so we cannot exclude that you have a publication bias. The studies presenting both overall survival and progression-free survival perhaps are particular. Perhaps you can have other studies presenting only progression-free survival because overall survival was not statistically significant. And so you're not going to include this study in your sample. Just, I would like to conclude with this slide. So, meta-epidemiology is an extrapolation of the concept of meta-regression, as I told you, and the summary points to consider when doing a meta-epidemiological study or when reading a meta-epidemiological study is how the collection of meta-analysis was done. Is it transparently reported? Is there a bias, a possible bias in the selection process, then It's important to use an adapted model, okay, like one of the three models I introduce. And this model is adapted because it takes into account clustering of studies within meta-analysis. And be aware of the coding each time. Okay, this is important because otherwise you may see no difference because of the coding. We need to systematically evaluate heterogeneity, and we need to take into account, if possible, in sensitivity analysis, meta-confounders. Because the main limit of meta-epidemiological studies is that it's observational studies, observational data, and you may have a risk of meta-confounding. So thank you very much for your attention. Do you have any additional questions? Were some points not clear enough? No? Anyway, if you have any questions after this lecture, you can contact me by email, and we can discuss if you are interested in such type of studies.